Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Call the October 17th meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners to order. And Ken, please join me in prayer. Almighty Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for all your blessings. Thank you for a beautiful day today. And just thank you for protecting us during the storm. And Lord, be with the ones down east that are still trying to figure out how to survive and just find a place to sleep tonight. Look after them, take care of them, be with our deputies as they go down there to help out and other responders, and just protect them as they work to help these people that are in need. God, we thank you for all you do for us. Help us to make wise decisions as a board tonight and do what's good in your will. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And Linda's going to sing Star Spangled Banner. Okay. Starting out with public comments, we have one, Mr. Tony Cox.
You know, I guess you could say in some ways that people down there in Haiti might have just a little bit better than the people down east. At least they got dry ground down there. But United States of America, you think, how does this happen? But I don't know. You know, I remember a few years ago, there was this great big to-do about here in the county about the carnival over there at Graham Hopedale Road and Church Street, how it was going to interfere with the agricultural, not-for-profit, agricultural county fair. But we ain't had a fair in years. I guess we don't celebrate the harvest anymore in Alamance County. We got too many other busy things going on. But a lot of stuff going on in this county that you wonder, why ain't the people getting these benefits? Why ain't the people getting these benefits? They say that one of the things that I heard about the dog shelter thing over there was, I heard somebody say that it cost $1,000 of the animal to pick those animals up and take them over there. I don't think they spend that much in human beings, do they? Or do they? I don't know. But it is what it is. We're hearing all over in this election about the corruption and fraud going on. The Hillary effect. The feds, they don't want to investigate Hillary for all this stuff. Then they go after Donald Trump. But you know, it seems like just a lot of bad things going on. I wish it would stop. Today, they done a life flight over there, Graham Hopedale Road and Church Street. I hope the person comes out good. But you know something, those people, our first responders and stuff, them people see stuff that I hope I'd never, ever, ever see. They see some tragedies, some really bad tragedies. And those people, I think in a lot of cases, I don't know if they get access to be able to talk to somebody or not, but that would be a really great thing for those people to have somebody to talk to. I really, truly believe that. And thank God for you people, the first responders. They're important people in our country. The most important people in our country. Excuse me, I'm sorry about that. But we got to get this country back on track. We slipped and went to a bad place over about the last 10 or 15 years, and we got to come back. And it ain't going to be from stupid stuff. It's going to be from people just like me over the years coming in here and opening your mouth. That's the only way to do it, is open your mouth and tell somebody. People say, you don't get nothing done, but every one of us here know that I do. And it's in a good, positive light.
Thank you, Tony. All right, any commissioner responses? Very good. Thank you, Tony. That is true about our first responders. They put it out there every day, and we thank them. All right, now if I can get an approval of the agenda, any additions, deletions?
Second.
Thank you, Linda.
I'll second.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? None. All right, consent agenda. Is there anything on that that someone might want to pull to talk about?
I move approval of the consent agenda.
Okay, second. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? None. All right. First on our list tonight will be a public hearing for the schedule of values. So I'm going to have Jeremy come up, I guess, and kind of tell us where we are with this, and then we'll get speakers to see if anyone wants to speak to this.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for having me back for my second of three meetings talking about the schedule of values. The goal tonight is to make sure that public concerns are heard. Now, in the 2 weeks since the last meeting, our schedule has been available within our office, online, and MJ with the libraries was so kind as to say if we can get her copies that she would host them in the reference section, so we've placed them there as well. In that time, we have had a little bit of feedback. We're actually beginning a kind of an errata sheet of things that we would like to change in the November 7th for approval, predominantly typos, spelling, source issues that have been caught. The only one that's of any real relevance to the schedule I want to cover very briefly so that the public will be aware of it, and we'll put this out on the website and amend the copies we have so that anyone that comes to view it from this point forward will be able to see those suggested changes. When it comes to laboratories and clean rooms, there's a little bit of a debate. How should they be assessed? And in ad valorem taxation, you have to differentiate between equipment that serves a building and equipment that serves a process. In the case of clean rooms, you have substantial equipment that serves a process. And so that would normally be classified as business personal property. And the questions come up, well, what if that gets challenged? Even though we classify as business personal, can we also assess as real? We want to be able to do that. So we are adding schedules for clean rooms to the real. We do intend to assess as personal, but should that be challenged, we have a real schedule ready to substitute in if the need arises. But I want to place that out for public inspection so everyone can see that amendment. Other than that, it's hearing the public with their questions or comments this evening. I'm here with my copy, and hopefully I can give some answers. I've also invited Harry Mincy. He's our senior commercial appraiser. He's the other author of the schedule, so that if there's commercially centered questions, he's probably the authority and not I. So I will step to the side if anyone has a question.
Thank you. All right. Well, we will go into a public hearing for this. Do I get a motion? Get a motion to do that?
I'll make a motion.
Thank you, Roger.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. And with that, we'll just start over here on the left side. And anyone that would like to speak to this, feel free. And just state your name, sir. I don't know who you are. So.
I'm the unknown. I'm Frank Bell. I'd like to speak briefly on the behalf of this evaluation. In 2009, a couple of guys, me and Gerald York, sat down and discussed some situations that we had. As all of you know, we had an award-winning evaluation in 2009. It was throughout the state of North Carolina, the reevaluation that we had. We knew that that could not be again. So we set out to sponsor and to try to get that changed in 2009. We met with some of the incumbents at that time. We met with the county manager and discussed our plan as to what we would like to see done in this county. It took several discussions, but it was endorsed. We began in 2009 to begin to hire some appraisers. We knew we had people that retired and they had to be replaced. They were replaced, but there was not replaced, they were just filled the position that existed at that time. Since that time, we have replaced several people. One of the major concerns that we had then, as you all know, was present use value status. And I will make this side note, to date, there has been 338 PUV farms that has been taken out of that program. Not because of who they are, but because they did not comply. That has increased our tax base. It cost us money to start with because in 2013 we hired a PUV employee. That's all his responsibility was, to check present use value taxes. As many of you know, that's a reduced value of what the real value is for people who farm. It was being abused. I got in a comment back in the office last week, and I do this quite frequently. I go back and talk to these people in the tax department, and I do it because I'm a taxpayer. And I do it again because I'm concerned about the future of the tax in this county and the citizens of this county. I was told at the last PUV meeting, which is statewide, Alamance County's department is being followed as a role model for PUV in the state of North Carolina. That's an accomplishment, folks. It's done because you endorsed our program and began to do something about it. Now, the standard of values, the first reevaluation started in 2014. That's when the tax department sent somebody out to reevaluate that parcel. For you that may not know, there's 70,000 parcels in this county. That's a monumental task to get done, and it started in 2014. As of this moment, those parcels has been visited, and I'm told that there may be one or two here and there that has been missed. But for the most part, all of these parcels has been visited and re-evaluated. I'm going to tell you something. I don't know. I've been in this county since 1960. I don't know that that's ever been done in this county. Every one of them that's been visited. That's an accomplishment within itself, folks. How can we know what the real value of the property in this county is if we don't go see? It has been done. I can attest to that. I have followed this process from 2009 up until today. And I'm aware and convinced, without a shadow of a doubt, that these people, Gerald started it, Gerald retired, it was taken over by this gentleman right here, Mr. Akins, and has done a superb job in communicating, in training. Today, folks, we have got a professional staff in the tax department. They can answer your questions. I don't care what it is. I ain't talking about as a layman, but as a professional, they can answer your questions and give you a satisfactory answer. We have hired part-time somewhere in the neighborhood of around 19 to 20 people. This is a monumental task. This was the intent to start with, to hire part-time people, because we cannot afford full-time people on staff. We need them today, tomorrow we don't need them. They have utilized that opportunity. We have hired, and I say we, but you know, I'm not on the payroll, but y'all understand the terminology. They have hired people with integrity, people that knows the business, people that has retired in other counties that know the business, and we have gotten it accomplished. Now, when they accomplish, this has taken a while, but there has been checks, and I will share with you tonight, that our former tax administrator, Gerald York, has looked at all of these values and has endorsed it. There is two other gentlemen, one from Lee County, one from Orange County, that was a tax administrator and has a certification in mass appraisal, people who know the business. You see, they have checked behind us to verify that there's not holes, and we have not overlooked something, and things of that nature. I was told just today those people gave their stamp of approval. I can tell you the reevaluation that's going to be presented to you is not a composite of figures of what we want it to be. It's figures of exactly what the marketplace would justify. It ain't no 3% increase. It ain't no 5% decrease. It's exactly what the market is. And I'm going to tell you straight up, and I think most of y'all know this, I personally will not endorse anything that ain't factual. We're not here to paint a pretty picture. We're here to be factual. And this is what the people of Alamance County, this department is known now to be people who want to help the taxpayer. That's all their mission. The taxpayer, me and you, are the people that pay their salaries. If you got a problem, we're going to have two sessions, January and February, to invite the public to come and let's discuss reevaluation. We want them to know what their job has been. We want the public to know what revalve is all about. We want them to know how we arrived at these figures. We want them to know that we're not the wolf in the woods waiting to shoot them, but we're the people here just trying to help them. And if they got a problem, we want to know what that problem is, and we want them to know the process that they can follow in order to get the solutions and solved. And that's proactive, folks. We ain't never done that. We stood over at a hole and said, hope nobody didn't come and give us a complaint. That's what professionals do. We're proactive. I thank them for being that. The training that they've gone through has been tremendous. Tonight, I want to thank them for the work they've done. And I want to thank you. This guy right here is a leg off of this and over here, but your communication with this department has been superb. Your communication with this department has been superb. We appreciate that. If we communicate and we set a goal of what we're going to do, plan for success, folks, because it'll happen. It'll happen if we work together. I can honestly say, without a shadow of a doubt, we're not perfect, and there's going to be some problems that arises. down the road. The only message that I would say to you is, it will be fixed promptly if you air the problem. We're not here to do anything other than to serve the public. I can endorse this set of values and be confident that the best work has been performed. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. Very good.
Thank you.
One thing I got, I missed
one more.
In June the 6th, y'all gave me an award for the Volunteer of the Year.
We did.
All of you signed it, and I appreciate it. But one lady didn't sign it.
Well, I was out. I was sick.
I understand
no excuses,
that.
No excuses.
But I covet that thing, so I brought it back to
life. Well, thank you.
I want you to sign it.
Thank you. Thank you, Frank.
I will.
All right. Anybody else on this side that would like to speak to that? All right. I'll work our way through here. Anybody on this side? Jennifer?
I pay a lot of taxes. I'm Jennifer Talley. Pay over 70-some thousand dollars in property taxes, and so I always get a little bit nervous for this process. Because 2009, I was like, have they lost their mind? I mean, this is crazy. Regardless of, whether you can pay it or not, the banks have become, it's a totally different animal now than it was in 2009. I think 2009, it was really difficult then, because banks look at your loan comes up for renewal. They don't care if you've made your payments on time for the last 20 years. That property has to cash flow, and the biggest expenses we have is taxes and insurance and, the interest that we're paying on the mortgages. So, we've got to make sure that I don't mind paying taxes. I like all the things that I get with taxes, but I want to pay my fair share, and I don't want to pay more than my fair share. So some of the questions that I have, and I just want to say, I've worked with Jeremy in the past. I've worked with Gerald York. I have over 80 rentals, and, if I come up there and complain about something, it's always legitimate. And I think I've appealed maybe less than five things the whole time I've owned property here. So I just want to know, with this reevaluation, that if property owners come in and they appeal something, that the board is going to be very open to that, because I never worry about winning an appeal, because I'm going to have all my evidence to show how this is. And just doing this for 20 years, I would say the appraisers would have to agree with me that when you're evaluating a property, neighborhoods is really plays a big factor in that value. And if you have square footage can only take you so far in an appraisal. And also what's happened in that neighborhood. So if the developer's gone bankrupt and, none of those neighborhood values are in this 368-page schedule. And it makes me a little bit nervous, because until you get the final bill, I don't really know if I'm for it or against it. So I think he's done an excellent job. And I looked at 09 and I was like, this is crazy. I even went to Gerald and said, how did this ever get passed? It was like a kindergartner had done it with a crayon. They've gone to a more, it's a little difficult to compare the two, but, basically all the site-built homes is a category. And then before it was all like, delineated out whether it was a brick or whether it was a vinyl or wood frame and all of that. So it made it a little bit more difficult to compare apples to apples. But I'm a little bit, are we going to find out about the neighborhoods? Like how we're going to do, but yeah, because remember the one that I appealed for on Pirtle Drive? Mm-hmm. Every house in that neighborhood had gone through foreclosure. And they, you know, if you take it just square footage, 1,500 square feet times 8,250 a square foot, it's like 123,000. And all the houses in there were selling $70,000, $80,000. And I think you looked at that neighborhood and you looked all around there. He can do that. I can't do that on GIS. He was like, this one sold for this one and this sold for this. And we were able to come up with a, you know, with a fair assessment. Right. But until you look at that neighborhood and where that house is, a 1,500 square foot house on Apple Street, nothing against people that live on Apple Street, but a 1,500 square foot house on Apple Street versus a 1,500 square foot on Davis Street versus a 1,500 square foot on Pirtle Drive, big difference in those values. And I just want to be treated fairly. So that was my first question to you.
Well, and I'll stand up.
Yeah,
That is exactly right. That is exactly right. When you're looking at the values, the neighborhood is extremely important. As a matter of fact, it's probably the most important driver of values, at least residentially. And so the only reason that it's not in there is it's not finished yet. When we send notices in February, will be the completion of our work. At that time, all the neighborhoods will be configured. At this time, we're going to be reviewing configuring the neighborhoods. The schedule of values is, in some ways, a toolkit. And our appraisers use that toolkit when they're assessing a neighborhood to construct their values, to go through the process of getting to a value. But it's just a toolkit. I've had neighborhoods that I've looked at that we've had to increase it 20%. I've had some that we've had to cut the values in half. And there's a reality to this. When someone is considering a home purchase, and if it's going to be owner occupancy, for one, they have to consider, do I want to live there? There are some neighborhoods that people generally do not want to live in. Okay, and so at that place, you're going to begin to get discounts, deep discounts on purchase transactions. Conversely, there are some magnetic draws that people will pay a premium for. And so without the neighborhood configuration, the schedule itself can't tell you what something's worth and so you place it in that neighborhood context. And as you'll see in the schedule, there are tools for adjusting for neighborhoods. Unfortunately, at this time, I don't have all the neighborhoods configured, but even if I did, I wouldn't want that hard-coded into the schedule. The schedule is the toolkit. The neighborhoods are the finished product, the parcels within that neighborhood context. But you're exactly right. If we didn't adjust for the neighborhoods, the schedule flat would over-assess and under-assess without the adjustment.
Big time.
Major, yes.
Okay, so that was my first question. So I just want to make sure that it's a kind of a free-floating, mm-hmm. you know, and that I'll be able to go to an appraiser that might be a new appraiser and maybe hadn't been doing it very long and may be able to say, yes, this is what Marshall Smith says, but here are all these other comparables, and then here's also our income approach and what I can, you know, lease this property for. Just doing the income approach, this is how I come up with my value.
Well, and if I can add, at the first year of appeals,
okay.
everything is fluid. So
okay.
if you come in 2017, and we recognize that there has been a problem in a neighborhood that we didn't address, we can correct it. And across the board, you don't change one, you change the whole neighborhood.
Okay.
Now, as you go into subsequent years, that gets harder and harder to do. So 5 years down the road, everyone else has been satisfied for 5 years, but you look at it and say, you know, I don't think that was right. It gets to be very hard to go in and change everybody. But in year one, everything is fluid. And in fact, I predict that we'll have neighborhoods that will get changed along the way based on the appeals that come in the door, the information that we get.
Okay.
There's another reason I don't want to hard code it.
I mean, there's 900 neighborhoods. I get why you don't want to have it in here.
Right.
It'd be another 368 pages, but I just want to, you know, I don't want to say I'm for it because I'm a little nervous about what the neighborhoods are going to come out. And, you know, when you do your calculation and determine a neighborhood, are you taking strictly like sale values? Is
well,
that how you determine?
The driver for a neighborhood is generally going to be sales, ideally within the last year. Sometimes we'll go back to 3 years just trying to get some sales, but of course then you have a moving market, so you have to look at time adjustments. This is why I prefer to be in the last year. We should come in, coordinated back to those sales. And the issue becomes, how much of that value is the land, for example? And so if you adjust lot values, then it changes values up and down across the neighborhood. And then if you control, if you feel good about your land valuation, then what's on the improvement? Is there actually a positive or negative influence on the improvements? And is that localized? For example, if you've got one row in a neighborhood that backs up to an industrial plant, odds are that those homes are going to be damaged economically by the industrial plant being right up against them, versus general effects to the whole neighborhood you want to adjust everyone for.
Okay. The difference between income, we've never gotten these. I don't know if you own any commercial property, but we've never gotten these assessment requests. Basically, the form looks like that. And basically, they want you as a property owner. These are just the commercial ones that I have, to basically say what your vacancy rate is and what your estimated rent is and all this. I like this because commercial property is investment property, and when banks look at investing, this is how they're valuing it. So I think it's probably a more true value. My question is, are you doing any of this for residential or just commercial?
So when you look at the applicability of the approach, you have to ask yourself about the highest and best use. If the home is most likely highest and best use under occupancy, probably wouldn't consider the income as a major factor. However, if you get into dominant rental properties, we see this with the old mill communities. You've got the mill housing that is turned over to a very high rate of tenancy. At that point, I would think the income is one of your dominant forces in determining value of the property. And very readily, I would adopt a value based on income, because highest and best use may be as rental investment property. Residentially, a gross rent multiplier might be a better way to fit some of the values, mm-hmm. as long as you have plenty of comparables of a very similar property type. With that middle band of mill housing rentals, that you probably do that. It gets more obscure than you might have to get into the more detailed breakdowns like you see for commercial. But definitely.
So are you able, that's my question, are you able to determine with this schedule of values, are you within your allowable, if they pass this,
right.
are you allowed to be able to look at the income approach for residential?
Yes, you absolutely
can. So if I think that's going to help me, then mm-hmm. I need to submit that to you.
Absolutely.
Even though you don't have a form.
Right. Well, and that's okay. The thing for both residential and commercial, we don't have a separate worksheet to value. It still runs off the same basic worksheet. What it does is it suggests adjustments to us. So if I have income coming in, I want to make adjustments through our cost-based form to coordinate and favor that income if I think that's the highest and best use. Sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. But in predominant rental property, that usually is your highest
right.
and best use.
Right. Okay. And, it's a big difference with, like, mobile homes. Mm-hmm. The reality of it is with people don't want to pay to live in a house that's a single wide mobile home versus a stick built home, even if it's the same square footage. So you have those values specifically, but as a landlord, if it's three bedrooms, it's three bedrooms. I don't care if it's a mobile home, and neither does the housing authority, neither does anybody that's renting it. They're renting it based on three bedrooms, two bedrooms, whatever. So it's still going to bring in the same amount of rent. So actually, they end up being more profitable, more valuable. So the appeals process, would that be by April 15th, or would it be in August?
I don't think August. I think that would probably end before then. The timeline for appeals is that when we send notices in February, along with those notices, there's going to be a written form if you want to appeal and write it. There'll be a web address if you want to do an online appeal. There'll be a phone number if you want to call in. Of course, you can walk in and come in person. That'll be the informal process. The formal appeals to the board, we're hoping to start those, the board meetings in May. So probably in April, we'll be getting the formal appeals coming in. In a typical year, we wrap those very quickly. As you know, the beginning of April, those usually cut off. because of the nature of the revaluation, we're going to need to keep that open for a longer period of time to make sure that all the appeals are in. We don't have a firm date yet, and really there'll be a date set by the board itself, so I don't know when that will be. But I would suggest that we'll at least run through the full month of May. Sometime in June, whether it's early June or late June, that'll be the board's discretion. They would set a cutoff date for appeal, but it will be an extended window because of the revaluation.
But we'll get the notice in February, and we'll have at least 2 months to appeal it.
Oh, absolutely.
It's hard to look at 80 yeah. some properties. So
if it goes out in February,
it takes me a long time to do it. That's what I'm trying to say.
You would have all of March, April, and May, and you'll probably have some in June. But I can't speak for the Board of Equalization exactly how they'll want to set that. But you'd have at least 3 months from the time of notice to the last chance to appeal. Could be as much as 4. Because again, this is different from a normal year. You've got a lot of properties to look at.
Right.
And then we want to make sure that we would rather wait longer and hear that appeal than close the door and not have correct the problem that needs to be addressed.
Will they handle it the same way they did before, whereas if you appealed, you won't hear them, but if you appealed and they saw that they made an error, they just fix it?
Yes.
And then if they say no, we're digging our heels in, then you actually go through the formal process?
Exactly. The,
okay.
the first wave, if we look at it, we see your point, we fix it, we're done.
Okay. And the other thing that I didn't find in the schedule of values after looking at all 368 pages, when you're looking for something specific, it would not be nice just a comment to have a little summary, you know, like your budget. I always look at that little summary at the beginning. I like that budget. That thing
helps.
Is huge. But a little summary might be helpful. But The acreage value, do you have any idea of out in the county, like what you think, how different that's going to change from the 2009 acreage value to present day?
Well, and I'll say I don't know exactly we're talking about change, because I would need to have a good feel for all the existing values. I do know that they range. They can be as low as 20 and as high as 35 out in the county for your first acre of buildable home site. But exactly where those breakpoints were set in, I don't know. 25,000 for a homestead acre was predominant in 2009. Now, I would say that we looked at all the land sales in Alamance County to kind of look for a typical county sale, and that 25,000 was supported if you've got good road frontage, you've got good soils, you've got a flat lot, you've got an even shaped lot, etc. If you have a good solid building lot, that's not an unreasonable number. If there's defects, we need to adjust it, and that's one of the big problems we had last time, is that a lot of the defects were not adjusted. They were taken, the adjustments were taken off. And so everything in the county ran as prime land.
Mm-hmm.
We spent a lot of time trying to adjust it down.
We thought it was prime
yeah.
back then, I guess.
So those adjustments that have been made have largely been kept. If there has been a change, it's been an individual change, perhaps by an appraiser reviewing through it, tweaking and refining, but by and large, if you got an adjustment last time, that adjustment is still in the system. Hopefully, we won't see the same type of problem.
When you have you just randomly, like this house I have on Pirtle Drive, have you just randomly picked houses and said, like, that one's valued at $78,000, it's a C-, which, by the way, is not bad. You think a C- would be, but it's actually beautiful, you know, perfect. Looks like a brand new house. But apparently AAA is Biltmore, so
yes,
it's
yes.
not Biltmore. But a C-, I didn't know that we had any AAAs here. Do we even have any AAAs here? Okay.
We have it. It's just like the clean room scenario is, if I think I might use it,
oh my
Biltmore
God.
Could be built here tomorrow.
I know, but it just
We've
makes you feel like
cookies,
C
so.
C is basically the base rate, and it's a C minus, and I guess it's because it's 10 years old or something. But that house is currently assessed at $78,000. Under the new one, it would be $123,750. How, if you don't have any minuses or pluses? Because you don't have that category anymore, brick versus vinyl, it's vinyl siding.
No,
have you done any of those and just randomly saw if there's an increase or decrease, are we pretty flat or?
Well, there's two different ways that we looked at it, and one is a schedule versus schedule comparison. And as you say, you're exactly right. It's hard to compare one directly to the other. There's a lot of things that had to be corrected going from 09 to 17, and in making those corrections, they now don't quite speak the same language with each other. And so the only way to test them was to take a model home and run it under each one and see what happens. And sometimes 09 was higher, sometimes 09 was lower. The 17 was always more consistent. The 09 was being inconsistent with the high and with the low. To look at actual examples, we've been very successful in fitting the model to actual sales. There are a lot of adjustments. Now, before, the materials were hard-coded into the property type. They're now an addition of the property type. If you look at the siding materials, they adjust the price per square foot for siding. So there still is a differentiation between a vinyl siding home and a brick siding home. But rather than putting that in a base code, which is an either-or situation, if you have brick front and three vinyl sides, we'll now have 25% brick and 75% vinyl. We wanted to be as accurate as possible with that. With a brand new home, there are fewer adjustments because you take most of the depreciation off the table. With an older home, depreciation has to be taken into effect. In fact, a lot of rental properties are quite old, and your level of renovation and upkeep can vary substantially, so that the condition is a huge factor. With a brand new home, you still can have functional depreciation or economic depreciation, but you'd have to look at the specifics of the laws there. If the neighborhood itself is depressed, you might have a neighborhood adjustment factor that apply even to a new home. And so if that value is typical to the neighborhood, we should be able to pull all the values down to reach an equilibrium where the sales and the schedule are not.
But out of the sampling you've done, did you find that to be pretty comparable to what was 09, because 09 was too high? And do you see not a big increase, or do you see that it was up or down?
We tend to be comparable on the average at the bottom line.
Okay.
But parcel by parcel, sometimes we're higher, sometimes we're lower.
But if you were to randomly take all of their property and pull what theirs is,
Right. You
think it'd be pretty similar to what the tax base is now?
I mean,
or what it was in 09?
Well, I'll tell you, individual properties, it's hard to say that because it was very inconsistently done. I'll give you a case in point is the depreciation scale. Before, depreciation was bracketed. So you could have 10 years of age on the home, would all get the exact same depreciation, and trips into the 11th year, and it goes into a separate bracket, and it gets a 10-year depreciation added to it. In cases where one home is at the edge of one bracket, and the home inside is a year older, same style, same builder, same everything, but a year older, put it in the other bracket, it's getting a 10-year depreciation gap between the two. Right now, we're running a percent by percent. So simply looking at the age of homes, because we're not bracketed anymore, if you were near one edge of the bracket,
Right. You're
going to go up. And if you're near the other edge, you're going to go down. Because we're not going to the middle anymore, we're going nearby. And that makes it hard.
And on that depreciation, do you account for 100-year-old homes? Because I remember my house was like 19-something. Mm-hmm. 1902 or something, and I got counted for like a 2002 house or something.
Wow.
So
we repaired most of that last time. That was
okay.
A conversion issue. Now, we'll say if it wasn't addressed last time,
that
it
was
may
fixed.
Still it may still be in the data, so I'm sure there's some home out there that still experiences that, but just has slipped by. But most of those have been corrected.
Okay. But will there be any public comment about the neighborhoods when you publish those? Because that's...
Yeah.
Well, no one came and commented about this last thing, the 2009
right. Thing.
And, you know, I asked Jeremy, you know, he said, tonight's the night to come and ask questions.
That's right.
And that's good. And we appreciate
this
you
is
coming,
like,
Jennifer.
This is a lot of money to a lot of people.
Yep.
And some people that are hanging on by their fingernails to pay their bills. So I want to make sure that it's right this time. He's done a great job from what I could tell, but until I get my tax bill, I really don't know.
I think a lot of your concerns that local people looked at the property this time. It wasn't out-of-town people coming in trying to tell us what the values were. And he used a lot of local realtors, builders, and stuff looking at the property. I think it's going to be more accurate just in that.
Well, I would say with the neighborhoods, the key thing is regardless of the specifics of the schedule, which are extremely important to me, is that for the average citizen, when you get your notice, when you look at that, if that's too high or too low, you say, well, I couldn't sell it for that, that's an incorrect number. The very fact that it's incorrect is grounds to appeal, and we will find a way to get to a correct value.
Okay.
Or if we're inconsistent, you say, look at my neighbor, you're doing one thing with them and a different thing with me, that is grounds, regardless of what the schedule is. And I understand the concern with the neighborhoods. I don't know that we're ever, after the fact, we can publish all of our neighborhood adjustment factors. We definitely could do that. But I think that what we're going to see from our point of view are the appeals coming in the door. And when we see folks coming in, lighting up a single neighborhood, we start adjusting that neighborhood. We adjust all the people that didn't appeal as well. And so those individual appeals are going to amount to neighborhood appeals.
Okay. All right. And my last question is for the county manager. I'm sure you were waiting with bated breath to get those, to find out what this is going to end up being. Do you have some idea of if there isn't the fiasco like we had with 09, which I don't anticipate us having, that is going to be enough revenue, what you estimate, what you think the new budget's going to be? Or are you looking at the tax basis? I mean, the tax basis goes up every year, but is it enough to not have to raise the tax rate?
That's a $64,000 question.
we all wish we knew that one.
I don't know, because we haven't gotten the total valuations at this point. So, and then you have to look at how much do you have to adjust for appeals. Part of what the issue was during the last revale is we adjusted 5% for appeals, and appeals ended up being about 12 to 15% for valuations. So when we thought we went revenue neutral, we did not go revenue neutral. We went revenue in the hole. So,
but if you adjust for 5% this year, which I feel a little bit more comfortable about, obviously, then are we revenue neutral or no?
Again, until we see the actual numbers, I don't want to put myself on a limb at this point until we see the final valuations and see where we're at. And those are conversations I'll have to have with Jeremy and the board about where we feel comfortable about what the appeals may or may not come in at.
And if we get the bills in February, do you have that information in January?
I don't know when Jeremy will have it, but it's a continual process. It's kind of a flow that continues, that is very, very fluid.
You sound like a politician.
No, I sound like a county manager who's been through a revale 8 years ago.
But this is a lot better than the reevaluation in 2009. This looks
we're
more professional.
And I appreciate the job Jeremy's done, and
done
Frank's,
a good job.
Frank's done, and Jeremy's entire department. And yes, we are more confident in the numbers moving forward. But again, it's real fluid right now, so I don't want to go out on a limb and say, yes, it's going to be a 5% increase, or yeah, we're budgeting this amount for appeals, or yes. Once we get closer, then we can, get more firm numbers.
And what day did that be?
Between now and July 1, 17.
Well, right. July 1.
There you go.
Because our budget has to be passed by July 1. So
that's right.
So by June 30th we'll have it.
Okay.
Thank you. Chairman, I can end on a positive note. We saved $600,000 before the revals ever come out, from the difference in what we paid last year and what we done in house.
That's right.
$600,000.
That was a gain to the county right there. Yes. Thank you.
Don't raise our taxes. That's a double whammy. That's what I'm here to say.
All right. Anybody else over here like to speak to the schedule of values? All right. With that, I'll take a motion to close the public hearing.
I make a motion to close.
Thank you, Roger.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Linda. All in favor?
Aye.
Now, we need a vote on this tonight, I'm guessing.
Well, there's no approval tonight. There has to be a third meeting.
Okay.
Which will be the November 7th meeting.
So we'll bring it back.
Well, okay. And we need to, one of the things I do have to ask later is about, do you still want to have a November 7th meeting scheduled? Since that's the day before elections, we typically cancel that.
Just cancel that. It doesn't matter to me. It's up to you guys.
Whatever.
How about you, sir? You all right? Cancel that night?
Lord, yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Dave. I appreciate that. All right. Very good. So we'll push that into the December.
Or that'll be the second meeting.
Second meeting.
Be 21st.
Seek the new board, right. Yeah. Okay. 21st of December, then we'll.
Or November.
November. I'll get my month straight in a minute. Okay. Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. Next, we have a presentation for Mr. Terry Johnson.
Commissioner, you know, some months ago, I approached the board about hanging a judge's picture in our historical courthouse. And the commissioners wanted to know who was going to pay for the picture. Well, I'm probably going to need a pardon from the governor's office, but I broke into Mr. Smith's house and I found a oil painting hanging in his bathroom. Now, who hangs an oil painting in his bathroom? And I noticed first it was face to face when he was in the bathroom, if y'all know what I mean. So, but what I want to do tonight, we do have the painting that I approached you, Commissioner, about. Right, I know right. All of you has been on board with this, and I want you to know I appreciate it. But I'd just like to say a few things. Nobody in this state has ever held the public positions this man has held in Alamance County. Have I always agreed with him? No, he'll tell you that. I threatened to throw him out the second story window several years ago of his office there, and it got printed in the Alamance News. And I was joking.
But I didn't think so.
In 1976, David Smith was appointed Superior Court Judge in Alamance County. He held court in 51 of the 100 counties of our state. Alamance County was county attorney, Alamance, 1996-2008. Clerk to the board, 1996-2008. County manager, 2005-2008. And I didn't think either one of us would live long enough to see the new jail built at that point in time. Because if he didn't kill me, I was going to kill him. County commissioner, 2012-2016. Chairman of the county commissioners, 2013-2014. And most important to me, was he served in our armed forces, going all over the United States. And I could go on and on tonight, but I'm not going to. I can tell you that, like I say, we didn't agree on some things, but I have all the respect in the world for him because we were able to work these things out. He's a very compassionate man, even though people think he's really hard-hearted. That is a sheep and wolf's clothing right there, I can tell you. And, you know, I talked to the board, and I think the board's got something to say, but before I do that, I want to ask Sammy Epps to come up here, because Sammy's gray-headed. Sammy probably saved my life several times in dealing with that jail and David Smith. So, Sam, would you like to come up and say a few things?
Sammy, were you the mediator for the two?
Well, if there wasn't so many women in here tonight, I could tell you a lot of good stories about the show. David, but I appreciate that. That's blonde hair, not white hair. So. There was some great times there with the jail being built and some other issues, but I don't have any more proud of a person than I am of David Smith. It was a troubled time, but you couldn't ask for a better boss than a man like that, because his background of making decisions, and it made a difficult time. And anytime you have to deal with the sheriff on a weekly basis,
backfired on me.
That's true.
I went to a job.
But I just like to say I'm very proud of David. He's a good friend and he's a good boss, and the county was very, very lucky to have him.
Thank you, sir.
Well, on behalf of the Board of Commissioners, we have a proclamation tonight honoring David I. Smith. And I'm going to read this to the everyone. Whereas the Alamance County Board of County Commissioners wishes to recognize and celebrate the role and importance of David I. Smith in its long and rich 167-year history. You weren't here at the beginning, I don't guess.
Okay.
Whereas David I. Smith provided leadership for Alamance County and citizens in dealing with the many important issues that have faced our community, and whereas it is important for the people of Alamance County to recognize the history and contribution of leaders in our county, and whereas David I. Smith has served in the following offices: State Superior Court Judge from 1976 to 79, and held court at 51 of the 100 counties
in 3 years.
And many other jobs. I'm going to Terry cover most of those. But the main thing, you've had a career of exceptional public service, and that's really what we're talking about tonight. Now, therefore, be it, and it hereby resolved, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners celebrates this service of David I. Smith to the state of North Carolina as Superior Court Judge and his service to Alamance County as County Attorney, County Manager, County Clerk, County Commissioner, and Chairman of the Board of the County Commissioners. David, thank you very much for having me.
And to show the people, here is the picture, and it did not cost the county taxpayers a dime.
Nice.
Is it sanitary?
Very good.
And the only thing that's missing, and y'all did, a lot of y'all didn't get to see it, there would be a set of horns right there.
He better listen.
Mr. County Manager, and I believe, I'm not sure on the procedure, but I believe commissioners need to vote in the courthouse.
Let me say to the people who are looking at that picture and then looking at me, the portrait's 20 years old. But I was even younger when I was a judge.
Yeah, he was a good judge. I had an opportunity to appear in court with him. If we had more judges like him,
have less mess we got
less
today,
crime.
Right? I would like a motion to, or I'm going to make a motion, how about that, that we put this in our courthouse. I think we're going to do it in a rotunda outside the courtroom, but I make a motion that we place this in the historic courthouse. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, David, and we look forward to that picture hanging over at the courthouse.
Thank you, Commissioners. I really do appreciate you being
right.
Kind.
We'll place a little plaque on the frame that'll with names.
And can you place a picture? I remember seeing a picture of Sammy and Terry and David at one of the meetings where they were driving the Barney car, you know. Can you find that picture and put it right beside?
I've also, there's a picture somewhere of the judge when his car got stolen, too. That was a look that I heard just could not be beat. So
that's right.
Kodak
all right, well, very good, and I think that was all in order that he received that. So. Next, I'm going to ask MJ if she'll come up and tell us about what's going on with Impact Alamance.
Well, that's a hard act to follow. We were notified that we were awarded a grant from Impact Alamance for $49,000 towards our first big pot of money towards the purchase of our bookmobile. So we were very excited and just wanted to let you all know that we had been given that grant opportunity and
we need
we're
to make
on the
an
road.
Approval to do mm-hmm. so. All right, I'll take a motion.
I move that we
thank you, Bob.
Approve it.
Second. Thank you, Roger. All in favor of accepting that?
Aye.
Thank you, MJ.
Thank you.
We look forward to that bus. Get that bus on the road. Very good. Next, Clyde, if you'll come and tell us about the landfill easement that you've written up here.
Yes, we need to get an easement to Duke Power Corporation so they can run power to our new building at the landfill. And under the law, it requires a resolution for this board to grant a easement to Duke Power for the purposes of running a power line underground to the new building.
So basically, if we want power, we have no choice but to make a motion to do so, right?
Yes, unless we want to start burning methane and generating our own.
That's right.
But we have an opportunity to go ahead and put it in this week, and with what's going on in the state with Matthew, it would be a good time to get done.
I'll make that motion.
All right. Thank you, Bob. Roger, thank you. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Moving right along, Susan Roberts is going to bring us up to date with our financial status.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm here tonight to provide you with our first quarter financial update. Here we go. We're good to go now.
Where'd
it go, Scott?
First thing we got to do is buy a new remote.
Exactly.
Can you put a little extra budget next year for a remote in it?
As you can see, Commissioners, from our fiscal year 15-16 budget to our comparing our 16-17 budget, we have had a amended budget now of $145 million, which is a budget percent increase of 1.99%, almost a 2% increase. Our revenues, we are right on track to where we were at this point in time. Last fiscal year, we've collected 43% of our budget. A big thanks to Jeremy and his staff with their collection procedures that helps keep us ahead of the game. And then if you look at your revenues overall, so far we have collected 0.04% increase of where we were at this point in time last year, percentage overall. The big increase that you see is in investment earnings. Where at this point in time last year we were at a little over 4,000. This year, right now, we're at 35,000. So there's significant growth in that market. Expenditures, we are comparable to where we were right there at 25%. Percent change in actual is 3.7% over where we were. Revenues over expenditures, right now we're at 22.6 for 15-16, 16-17 we're at 21.5. Other financing sources, we were $75, and this year we've already completed our transfer that you approved at last board meeting to the school's capital project fund of $1.7 million, bringing our net effect, we were at 22.6 for 15-16, 16-17, we're at 19.8, so net effect of revenues over expenditures. So last commissioner's meeting, Commissioner Byrd asked a question about how the economic incentives were affecting our fund balance. And the way that we budget for those is when the contracts have been approved, that expense will be budgeted against the revenue that they should bring in. So there's no net effect to our fund balance. Where there is an effect is when we have an agreement where there is funds that are paid ahead of time. So what we did for Walmart, our construction, the infrastructure that we paid, and so far this year, that has been an impact to fund balance of $304,000.
Can I ask a question about the first slide with numbers on it?
Sure.
Amended budget.
Yeah. So for 2016-2017, mm-hmm. we adopted a budget of 142.
Yes, sir.
So when was June 30th that we amended it? I mean, because...
That was a typo on there. It's September 30th.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Well, it's good to know we are on track, and mm-hmm. thanks to Jeremy and his collections, keep yes. that good work up. So.
Is the sales tax still coming in strong like a...
It is, Commissioner Parker. Right now, we are seeing a 14.7% increase in sales tax for where we were at September 30th to where we are now at September 30th. We are still seeing an increase there. August collections were down a little bit, but that could be people traveling. So it'll be interesting to see how September comes in next month.
There's also a lot of reimbursements mm-hmm. on that in August you get. So that was across the state as well.
Yes.
So intergovernmental, those are government grants typically?
Yes, right? sir.
That, Susan Osborne gets and Stacy.
That's our federal and state reimbursement, things of that nature in that category.
So we had a couple of grants to, I think, between last year and this year.
Yes, sir.
And then sales and services, what makes up that and why is that decreasing?
In that category is our ambulance fees and our jail rental fees, as well as other miscellaneous department fees and services that we have there. Right now, our jail fees are down slightly. That could be due to the initiatives that they've had with, you know, local misdemeanor programs. So but we'll watch that and monitor that throughout the year.
Very good. Any other questions?
You're welcome.
Thank you, Susan.
You're very welcome.
Thank you, ma'am.
All right. We have a request for budget amendment for the Sheriff's Department.
I'm appearing before the Commissioners tonight to ask that transfer some of our federal drug seized asset forfeiture money to purchase two vans. We are purchasing two Nissan vans, gets about 38 miles to a gallon, and they're whole lot cheaper than some of the other vehicles, and we're taking the vehicles assigned to our CSI unit and giving them to the new deputies that we are hiring, trying to be as tax concerned as possible.
So the vans will go to the CSI?
CSI.
Which is probably a better vehicle anyhow for what they do.
Yes, sir. Sure is. And that money's transferred. Of course, we purchased these vehicles, and it will be no cost to the taxpayers.
I entertain a motion to
I'll make a motion.
Accept it.
I'll second it.
Thank you. Roger, thanks, Bob. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Very good.
Thank you all very much.
Sir.
I'd like to say something right quick.
Yes, sir.
A couple of weeks ago, I attended Alamance Academy. Mm-hmm. I think it's called 101. I'm not
county
sure.
Government,
anyway, that particular week, there's about 15 people in there, and I attended that. And that week was public safety. And we met here, and then we went over and heard from Chief Deputy Tim Britt and others. Then we went out and looked at a squad car and all the equipment that it needed, everything about it. Then we had a tour of the jail. And I'd never, thank you, Lord, I'd never been in the jail.
That's the question.
So it was kind of new to me. Didn't know what to expect. But I just want to say right now up front that that was the most professional. Every person that we dealt with was first class, knew the job, was very nice, and everyone in that group came away with a positive attitude. So thank you very much, Sheriff, you and your guys.
Yes, sir. Good job. All right. Next, hey, Stacy.
So I have two budget amendments from the health department for you. I think the first that you all are seeing is the dental clinic. Mm-hmm. And presented before you is a budget amendment for $40,000. This was a grant received from Impact Alamance. There are no matching funds. These are all foundation funds. And the funds will be used to replace equipment in the Clinical Bay area in our children's dental clinic.
It's amazing how much Impact Alamance is affecting our community.
Sure is. Very generous.
It's very generous.
Yeah, as the commissioner, member of the Board of Health, I'll move that we accept.
Make
that,
that move. Okay. Thank you, Bob, and I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you, Stacy.
And the second one, the second budget amendment that you have is for the health department in the environmental health section. This budget amendment, I think it states grant, it's actually an allocation from the Division of Public Health for the summer food program. This funding is received by the North Carolina Division of Public Health for the summer inspections that we do. This is actually a summer food service program that is a USDA funded program that reimburses sponsors for free meals that they provide for the economically disadvantaged children during the summer. And then our department, through Environmental Health, who is charged with the food and lodging inspections, inspects those facilities as well for sanitation and food inspections. And so this is the allocation that we received for those inspections that we did during that time.
Okay.
there is no local match for these as well.
All right. I entertain a motion to do this.
I'll move on that one.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. That was quick. All right.
Thank you, ma'am.
Next, we have a request for performance management for MIS. Bruce, I guess you're going to bring us up to date about that one.
Well, I've been on the job about a year and a half with the IT department, turning over rocks and doing upgrades and different things like that, getting up to speed with standardization and doing it the right way. And recently, we upgraded our email system from 2007, which is a long time ago. And they had some new tools in that. And in running those tools, we found out that our Microsoft licensing was lax. And so we were about 366 licenses beyond where we need to be. So what I'm asking you is to use our performance money to make that right. That's 167 licenses, and then we will absorb the rest of it in the IT department. So 366 licenses to get us right with Microsoft. You have to be professional, you know, when we sign contracts and those kinds of things. And as soon as we discovered this, I took it to management, and you know, we all said we wanted to bring it before the board and, you know, do it the right way.
Now, does this cover security Microsoft?
It covers anything that Microsoft does. You have a 3-year, every 3 years you have an ELA agreement with Microsoft, but you're supposed to self-report as you get new and new licenses and anything that gets on the network. And so, like I said, running these new tools, we were lax, and this is the right thing to do. It's what we signed contracts to do these things. And again, it was a big rock to turn over and get right. But
we don't want WikiLeaks people jumping in.
Well, the big issue that we had is we add on computers, we add on laptops, we add on Surface Pros, we add on all this that are Microsoft, and we have not self-reported back to Microsoft in the past that we had new license that we needed to. So I appreciate Bruce and his staff for finding this and making it right. But also, we're using performance-based money for this. This is, you know, really money that's already
set aside in the fund.
So, and Bruce, the total is about 130.
100,546.
100,546.
The total
with for 366 is 217,751.
So part of it's going to come from his current budget, right. And then the other part is going to come from performance. So, and I applaud Bruce and his staff for finding that and willing to use performance money for this.
And it's a hit. No, there's no doubt there's a hit there, but you have to be compliant.
You need
And I agree. I mean, in my former employer, that was a big deal.
It's a matter of
integrity, and it needs to be done.
Right.
What level Windows? I assume you use Windows, right?
Yes.
What level is that?
Oh, we're up to 7. You know, at some point we'll go to 10 because it's the professional version. We have people that use 10. You really, on the back side where the servers, that's where it's, you got to catch, you know, you at home, a lot of people have 10 now, but to get to 10, the servers all have to be up to speed, and all the software that people use in Microsoft have to have theirs all the way updated and ready to go. Usually governments toward the end of implementation on 10.
So they're ready to step up one time you get to it.
Right. And one of the big steps to do that was to go, we had some servers as old as 2003 in the 911 center, which Microsoft does not even support that anymore. So we had a lot of major upgrades to do while 911 works and all these things. So we've made a lot of headway. And with the email system, we moved up from 2007. So these are all the steps you have to take ahead of time on all the servers and all the applications before you can jump to 10.
It's a constant battle, isn't it? Keeping up with technology.
I wouldn't do an upgrade down a very critical time.
No. And I told everybody, I said, we're about to start the election period. We're going to take, you know, no major upgrades.
Big upgrades right now.
That's it. We want to be right there. So.
All right. I'll entertain a motion to do this. Thank you, Roger.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Very good. All right, county manager, what you got to tell us?
I do, got a couple of things. One of the things I do want to mention is you mentioned in your prayers about the flooding from Hurricane Matthew down east, and I do want to recognize our departments that have been participating. The Sheriff's Department, we sent 12 people down. They came back today. We're going to try to formally recognize all those that have been deployed at our meeting in November. We had people from the Health Department, four. Are we resending as well?
They're on the deployment list. They have not been deployed as of today.
Yeah. So food stamps. And Susan, we will be doing remote food stamp applications for those counties that have been hurt. Our emergency management planner, Matthew, I always say his name, Kimnitz. has been deployed.
He's supposed to come back to county tomorrow. He's been down there 4 weeks so far.
So I do want to say through all of our mutual aid agreements and the work that Susan and Stacy and Debbie and Johnny have done, that I'm and the sheriff just very proud of the work that we are doing in support of our neighboring counties down east who are really going through a tough time. And what I would like to do at, again, our November meeting is bring all those that have been deployed directly and bring them in, and we'll recognize them at that time.
I think that'd be very appropriate.
Yeah. And I'd like to thank the commissioners for allowing me to send my people down there. They come back with a different attitude for Alamance County, and it's really bad down there. There are alligators, there are snakes, and my lieutenant brought a copperhead of a copperhead snake they killed about as big as your hand.
I ain't going
to do it.
We don't need to do a walkthrough.
Like I said, those people are going to put a lot of time to
yes, sir.
I remember many prayers. So we may have to deploy 12 more, and I want to thank our county manager for making it possible, because there was a whole lot of stuff we had to buy. FEMA's going to reimburse the county, but we had to do it in the spur of the moment.
Right.
And he allowed us to do that, and I want to thank you and Susan.
Okay.
That's the right thing to do.
It is.
Yes,
very much the right thing to do. And that's what we're trying, part of our core values of who we are.
That's right.
The other thing I do want to we'll recognize Libby Hodges right quick. Libby's going to recognize the winner of our naming of our strategic plan.
So we don't always get to do just kind of fun, light things around here at the county, because we've got some real serious stuff that you guys do, and thank you for all of that. We really appreciate all that work. But I wanted to present Steve to you tonight, because he was the winner of our naming contest for the strategic plan. He came up with Vision Out. So here you go, Steve.
Thank you very much.
Are you going to, and here's your prize. Are you going to do your interpretive dance? No. I was hopeful,
later.
If you want to say anything, you can.
I just want to say that I appreciate the county. I love living in the county. I love my job. I feel blessed with the people I work with. It's just a great place to work, so I'm excited about that. Thank you very much.
You work for the county?
He does. That's a lot of good work.
Just a couple of the things. The City County Dinner at AO Fire Station is this Thursday night at 6 p.m.
We're going to be with Frank.
To remind you of that. And also, I ran into our favorite parade director, Miss Brenda Perry, today. She wanted me to remind everybody of the third annual Veterans Day parade that will be in downtown Graham on Friday, November 11th, and the parade will begin at 1 p.m. So Brenda was very excited. I think even as of today, she's had 71 entrants into the parade, and she said her phone was ringing off the hook of other people wanting to be in the parade. So she's still, we love Brenda and miss her, but she's still being active. Very active, and
very good.
She's still the queen of the parade.
So. All right. Last year we had a commissioner's vehicle in the parade. Mm-hmm. Can we do that this year?
That would be nice. We can.
Have you got a vehicle?
If we can come over to convert Rusty to
we'll have his bar. We'll take care of that. But also, what if we are good about canceling the November 7th meeting? I probably need a motion for that.
I'll make a motion that we do not do the November 7th meeting.
Okay.
Thank you, David. All in favor? All right.
Judge, you want me to throw in the 21st in there, too?
I think we legally have
to. Oh, okay, we got to have one a month, right? That's right. That's the legality thing there.
That will be my last full meeting. Right?
Yeah, yes, sir.
By the way, do I get paid for December?
All right. Any commissioner comments?
Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to thank Terry for getting all of this going, and appreciate it. And he's right. We, I would say the 3.5 years that I was manager here were the most fun time I've had in my entire life. And he did threaten to throw me out of my window several times. I finally decided he didn't have to throw me out. I was going to jump out. I know that the manager and the county attorney helped in this, and I appreciate it from all of you. I've got one story about Sammy Epps that I've got to tell.
Oh.
Sammy was assistant county manager for those who are young and weren't around during that period of time. And he always claimed that he was able to, you know, I would get people all upset, and then he'd go in and smooth things out.
Chill.
So he said one day to him, he said, David, you know, we work pretty good as Mr. Bad Guy and Mr. Good Guy. And I said, Sammy, you're not that bad. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I know everybody's in a hurry, but I've just got to tell this story on David's face. When David became county manager, he had his own little parking place behind the building where he come into work. He said, Sheriff, I'm the county manager now, and if you see a car parked in this spot other than my BMW, I'm ordering you to tow it. So one day, I come in and I see this loaner car that David had dropped his car off at the dealership, and my chief deputy, now dead, went over to Dick Shirley and forced Dick to give him an extra set of keys. We come, move the car over to the Board of Elections. Well, every time I ever come over to David Smith's office, he'd say, Sheriff, have you done anything at all today? You know, I come bouncing in. He said, Sheriff, have you done anything at all today? I said, David, you're going to be proud of me. He said, what did you do? I said, you remember your parking place back there, and you said any car on that BMW? I said, I told you. David was standing up. David said, told it. I said, and he sat down at his desk. He said, Sheriff, that was a loaner car. $100 in the shop. What have we got to do to get it back? I said, tow bill's $125. He said, how am I going to get over there? I said, I'll take you. So we got out there, and when we walked by where the car was, he said, you're not joking, are you? I said, no, I'm not joking. What did you tell me to do? I was mumbling, and I was like, what did you say to him? And what was he putting out? We walked by my car. He said, well, there's your car. I said, no, you need to follow me. Walked around the side of the Board of Elections building. And that's where we parked it. And the Board of Elections was getting ready to have it towed. Then just put a sticker on
it. Thank you for sharing that. That's a good one.
That's what I had to put up with.
I know. That's very honorable of you to stay in that job with that, right?
All right. I had hair when I started.
I did too.
He did too.
All right. Any other comments? With that, then we're adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.